All right. Welcome, everybody. I'm Stephen Teal, your host of the Northwest Fishing Club podcast. As always, I've got my friend and co-host, Todd Logan. And tonight we have a special guest with us, Robert Kratzer. Robert has been a guide in Washington for, I believe, 35 years, and is also involved with a lot of organizations, including Hatchery Wild Coexist and the Washington Guides Association. So thank you very much for joining us tonight, Robert. Wanted to give everybody that doesn't know you just a little bit about your background. How'd you get started in guiding?
So I just fished like all the time. Once my dad took me fishing as a little tiny kid, that was all I ever did was go fishing. And my dad and I built a wooden drift boat before I was age of driving. And as soon as I could drive, I had a drift boat I could go float in and go fishing. And it just kind of morphed into me going everywhere. And then eventually I had friends that, you know, I would go off fishing somewhere and they would stay at our home river and it wasn't good. And where I went was great. And I'd go back the next weekend and they go, hey, you mind if I bring so-and-so, or hey, can I bring my dad or whatever. And it just kind of morphed into eventually, I just had so many people asking me to take them fishing that I started charging a little bit of gas money. And then I started charging a little bit of money. And then I realized that I should just do this for a living. And so I did that and quit my job and became a guide. Not the wisest choice at the moment. It worked out just fine. But when I first started, I started thinking, sometimes I thought, wow, was this really smart?
Did you have to work for other guys starting out? Did you have to work for a bunch of other guys, or did you just kind of be able to build up your own clientele right away?
No, I was able to build my own clientele right away. And it kind of, the absolute best thing I ever did was I had two local stores that, you know, back in the day, there was fishing and tackle stores all over the place. And there were two local stores, and both of those stores were like, hey, would you put your cards in our shop? And I said, you know, I said, I'd love to put my cards in your shop. However, when you give out a card, I'm actually a reflection of you giving that out, right? So if I do a bad job, it actually comes back on you,
right?
Also. So I said, I'll make you a deal. How about I take you fishing for the weekend? Take you fishing for a weekend. You bring a friend, wife, whoever, come. At the end of a weekend, if you still want to give out your cards, then you're more than welcome. And I did that with two different stores. Cool thing is they both enjoyed themselves and they couldn't keep my cards in stock in their stores.
That's awesome.
So they threw out cards so fast. In fact, I still have probably 20 clients from back then that I'm still fishing with today from back then. So that was probably one of the better things I did back then. And of course, 37 years I've been guiding, but 37 years there weren't as many guides. There wasn't social media. There wasn't a lot of stuff like that. So word of mouth was your best choice. And that was good. So
have you spent your whole time guiding just in Washington, or I believe you went up to Alaska for some time, right?
I did. I spent 35 years in Alaska. I actually worked at Mission Lodge as a guide. Then a couple years later, I was the head guide. Then like 5 years later, I became the full-time manager. And I managed that lodge for 20 years with my wife. And then we actually built Alaska Kingfishers on the Nishigak.
Okay.
For that lodge. And then helped them run it for a period of about 8 years. And then my wife and I purchased it from them. And so we ran Alaska Kingfishers on the Nishigak for 16 years before I sold it. And then I continued to go up there and manage for another 7 years. And then when COVID hit, I didn't get to go and I stayed home and fished and decided that I had a lot more stuff going on at home. So I just would stay home and stick around here now.
Gotcha. Seems like, I mean, at least some of the bigger guides that I've seen from around our area, you know, used to go up to Alaska every year. And now a lot of them have all just started guiding full time at home instead of going up there. You know, it's kind of interesting to see that transition.
Well, what the transition is, and I've always said this, and I've always said it, like even with all my employees, was you want to hire the absolute best employee you can. but the best employees you can hire are also the people that have great drive. And those people that have great drive eventually want something for themselves. So they're either going to buy the business from you, they're going to start their own business, or they're going to move on, right? So
right.
Alaska is wonderful. However, you know, to just go there and guide, you can make a living, but as you get older and you have a family and you have stuff going on, that living is a little more scarce. It's not quite as profitable. And so eventually any guide that's worth his salt decides that he's going to start something of his own up there, or he's going to stay home and fill his boat every day and probably make more money just staying at home.
Right.
Well, it's more of a stepping stone and a portfolio builder than a destination.
You're right.
You know, I think.
Yep. I agree.
And now with guiding, it seems like you've started getting involved with a lot of these organizations that are working on improving our fisheries. You know, I know that you work with Hatchery Wild Coexist and the Washington Guides Association. What made you start getting involved with those? And, you know, what kind of role do you actually play in those organizations?
So actually, I started quite a long time with the Olympic Peninsula Guide Association, which I'm a board member on there. Of course, that's a more local organization just on the peninsula, and I've been with them for probably 20 plus years, and then I started an organization called Northwest Olympic Peninsula Sport Fishing Coalition.
Okay.
And that one was businesses and fishermen affected by fishing rules and changes. So that one, we pull in a lot of the local businesses mm-hmm. to get involved, because obviously hotels, restaurants, all those kind of people, they're affected when fishing goes south.
100%.
They lose, right? So they're affected. So we put a coalition together for those folks to be actively involved. About 3 or 4 years ago now, going and being involved in some meetings. I've been involved for quite a while, but getting more involved, one of the meetings that we got involved with, one of the folks from Fish and Wildlife basically just said, you know, as guides, you guys just don't have a seat at the table. Like, you're not organized. You're not together. You don't really have anything. So without a seat at the table, you don't really have a voice.
Gotcha.
And so a couple of us were like, oh, you want a voice? Okay. So Doug St. Denis and myself said, all right, let's do this. So we started the Washington State Guides Association, and in pretty quick form, we got that up and running, got our board together, started getting membership right away and so forth. And then in all the meetings that I do and all the organizations, I've been on 4 different ad hoc groups from Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife, being involved in those and everything. The guys from Hatchery Wild Coexist asked me, hey, would you like to be an executive director of Hatchery Wild Coexist and join this fight with us? And I said, you betcha. And so I'm an executive director for them. I'm the vice president for Washington State Guides Association, president of Northwest Olympic Peninsula Sport Fishing Coalition, and on the board for the Olympic Peninsula Guide Association.
As a guide,
I currently sit on the Coastal Steelhead Ad Hoc Group, and then I also sit on the Guide Advisory Committee to the Department of Fish and Wildlife.
No, as a guide, I mean, the job is pretty much a 12-16 hour a day job. How do you find the time for being a part of all those organizations?
Oh, well, first and foremost, I would say I have one heck of a very understanding wife and kids that allow me to do this, and they know how important it is that I do this stuff. I have to just manage my time, manage my meetings, manage my time. I'm a pretty organized individual. So I manage all those wells. And every once in a while, there's a time frame where these meetings cross and you know, like if I had a meeting tonight with the Washington State Guide Association, I would just tell them, hey, I'm going to do this podcast with these guys. I'll talk to Doug tonight and get caught up on what happened in the meeting.
Gotcha.
And so forth. So then, of course, emails. I do a lot through emailing stuff because they all send their agendas and their minute meetings and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So, and I just, and to be honest with you, I mean, there are times I just have to take days off. I mean, I have some of these meetings that I have to do with Department of Fish and Wildlife. They're in a time frame where I just can't do it. I have to be on a Zoom call like this, and I just schedule those days off. And then there are quite a few of the meetings that I do during the daytime. I put my earbuds in, I put it on mute, I listen to the meeting, I'm guiding all day, tell my clients I got to do this. And fortunately, all my clients understand. They're like, no, we appreciate it. Keep doing what you're doing, you know, and I just guide them along the way. So,
gotcha.
So I got a quick,
yeah, go ahead. Todd.
Well, I had a quick question, you know, in all the, is there in all the organizations that you donate your time to, Bob, is there, do you see a bottleneck that runs pretty much throughout every organization of what needs to be opened up? That makes sense of information, I guess, you know, where, you know, the, it gets lost from the meeting to the outside, you know?
Yeah. That's definitely a struggle. No doubt about it. There's definitely a struggle in there. And it's something that myself and Doug have been talking about with the Washington State Guide Association and how to communicate that better, how to get that more open and out there a little bit better. We just had a guy just called me a couple of days ago and had a long conversation with me about some stuff. And then, and in fact, he called me the morning after the Addicted show I was on. And I thought for sure he had listened to that. Come to find out he hadn't listened to it. He just called me out of the blue.
Yeah.
And didn't know that he could join as an angler to the Washington State Guide Association. And he's like, oh my God, I didn't even know that. I'll call. Mm-hmm. And so in that conversation with him, that subject came up. And so it's something that we're working on, and it is something that you're correct. I mean, those things need to be worked on to really get it out there in front of everybody, for sure.
Yeah, because I think there's a lot of, I don't want to say misinformation, but there's a lot of knee-jerk assumptions and emotions based around some of the ideas that people have as far as, you know, make more hatchery fish, flood the rivers with hatchery fish, every one of them. And people are, you know, sometimes delusional on what that means. You know, what is, you know, one of the questions I had for you is, what does the hatchery production consist of? What does that state, more hatchery production, what is that, how does that even begin to be a solution, if it is a solution?
Well, I mean, I would start out with saying that it's a solution in some systems, for sure. I there are systems where you either have, now this is looking at a state side, right? So the right. Being involved in all the meetings I am, there's a reality, and we talked about it a little bit before. There's a reality. The one person says, hey, just plug everything with hatchery fish. Just put them everywhere.
Right.
It's a great thought. However, the reality of it is that we do have wild fish in all of our systems. We have wild fish in our systems. You have them in Oregon. We have them in Washington. We have them around. And it is something that we need to protect, right? There's a reason we release wild steelhead. There's a reason that we release a lot of wild salmon, is so that we can protect those fish and that we have them. Now, I'm not a firm believer of a hatchery fish diluting the wild population to where wild fish aren't there. I'm not a firm believer of that. I think right. That happens far more than we think. And I think those fish have survived greatly. And I think that some of our wild fish are derivatives of hatchery fish that spawned in the river.
Do you know and if there's been any new studies done on that interaction? Because I believe most of the things go based off like an old Hood River study, if I remember right, that said, you know, that hatchery fish had an effect on the wild population. But that was like the 80s, if I'm not mistaken. Do you know if there's been anything more recent that studied that?
there has been some. There's a recent one off the Wilson River. And then there was one out of Oregon. Let's see. The biologist in Oregon, and I'd have to look it up again. I can't remember exactly which one it was. But there has been some studies that show that those aren't as strong as we think. The Clackamas River, I know, just came out with a paper that was written that basically said that they removed all the hatchery fish from the upper system of the Clackamas River to help the wild populations, and come to find out that was like a travesty, that actually that's what was keeping the whole system alive, was those hatchery fish that were up there.
Gotcha.
Including the wild fish. And so there are some things that point in the opposite direction. But I think, you know, I mean, first of all, you have to look at every river system individually, right? You can't put this on a broad spectrum. You know, one river is suited for it, one river is not. You know, where are you going to put the hatchery? How many fish are you going to plant in a hatchery? How many wild fish are there? And what kind of interactions are you going to have with those wild fish? And so forth, right? And so that's how you start, is start the conversation around a hatchery. You got to look at all those things, and then you got to look at the cost, and you got to look at, you know, the implementation of it. It's a big item to sit down and really process all of that. And like I said, there are systems where the wild populations are basically to the brink of extinction, that basically with the habitat that they have and where the wild fish are, there really isn't any hope, long-term hope, for those wild fish. Right. In our present habitat, our present ocean conditions, those kind of things, there just isn't a lot of hope for certain systems. Those are the systems that we look at and say, hey, we really need to put a hatchery system in here. You know, let's put some hatchery in there. Let some people catch those fish. Let's do that. There are other systems that, you know, are kind of in the middle of the road, where they have good wild production. They don't seem to get over the hump, but they have wild production, and there is a future for them if we protect them correctly. You can still have hatchery production in those streams. Those streams might be really good for broodstock production to really help bolster those wild populations. Right. And then there are a handful of streams that are just really, really healthy wild populations, or have the ability to be really wild populations, where you have limited or you have maximum habitat, you have maximum amount of wild fish coming back, and the promise for that. So maybe those are ones that we don't want to mess with, and we just want to have some really strong wild populations that we either catch and release and we go and enjoy, but not do that. So I mean, when you start looking at, and that's how the state would look at that, right?
Right.
And so the state has to analyze all of that before you even sit there and talk about, hey, just put hatchery fish there, right? They immediately like, oh, okay, let's, all right, we'll look at it. And this is how they go about looking at it. Where is that stream? What's the habitat? What's the wild population look like? And so forth, right? So it's a, you know, I know there's some things in there that probably I said that somebody's gonna like, well, I disagree with. And I'm going to tell you right now, I probably disagree with a little bit of what I just said. I'm not telling you what I just said. I'm telling you what the Department of Fish and Wildlife, how they look at it,
right,
and how they want to go about it. And so our job as folks is to recognize how they look at it, and then figure out how you can partner with them to help them achieve what you want to achieve.
Otherwise, we're just constantly fighting against each other. You know, and nothing's ever going to get done with, I mean, as we see, we are where we are now,
right?
You know?
Yep.
And so, I mean, with those hatchery programs and how the state looks at it, I believe that it's a lot data driven, right? I mean, they have to be able to know what the effect of that hatchery is going to be and be able to collect that data coming back. Otherwise they might not be able to do anything if, you know, they don't have the proper collection site or, you know, because one of the big debates down here in Southern Oregon is hatch boxes. And from what I've heard from our biologists here is that they can't really support that because there's no way for them to collect that data on how many fish are coming back because of the hatch boxes, you know? So it's kind of, interesting that I'd agree with you 100%. You know, we have to learn how they look at it and then attack the problems from that angle.
Right, for sure.
And I would sympathize with the guy that says that about his data and hatch boxes and say, okay, I understand that. Okay, now I want you to come out and look outside your box a little bit from the department guy and say, okay, look outside your box a little bit. We think this really has a positive, could be a really positive thing for our anglers, for our fish, and so forth. So just instead of saying we don't support hatch boxes, say, how can we support hatch boxes?
Yeah.
What do we need to do to collect the data that you would like to support the use of hatch boxes?
Yeah.
Right? Put the question back on him and say, okay, now how do we do that?
I'd agree with that.
And then start 100%. And then start that conversation with him and figure out how to do it.
Right.
There's a way, right? Sometimes it's easy for him just to say no.
Right.
And as opposed to coming up with a solution, right? And that's our job, is like, let's push a solution. Right. Well, I get it. And if it hatch won't work, then what will work? Right? Let's work on something together to come up with a positive end for this.
Right.
Well, I think, you know, not just to play a little bit of the devil's advocate, you know, everybody they get beat down. I don't think anybody's come to them with the idea of how we work together for a solution. It's either my way or the highway, and how come you can't see it my way and you're screwing it up doing it your way? You know, there's no, like you did, to approach it like you just said is far more productive of, you know, all right, then if let me know the rules that we need to play by and go from there, you know. And I don't, you know, I'm just speaking of myself that I haven't went to the biologist and done any of this. I don't know if other guys have or not, you know, but I definitely on board with that. That approach, I think, will get you a lot farther than you haven't been doing your job. And you know, I mean, you know, the constant barrage of degrades, you know, the person's only going to take so much of that before they just tune you out. And you're off their list of prospects.
So most of the, I would say, just isn't guides. This is just sportsmen in general.
Yeah.
You're 100% correct. You know, how many people call their local biologist and say, hey, good job on that decision. Hey, good job on doing this, or good job on that. Right.
No,
they
I don't need
praise every once in a while, because they do a lot of really good stuff.
They do.
And they do some stuff right. And they spend a lot of time. I mean, I don't know how many times I've had a biologist call me at 8 o'clock at night and I'm like, dude, what are you doing? Well, I'm calling you back. I got to get a hold of you. No, what you got to do is go spend time with your wife. Call me tomorrow or something.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, you got a family too. I mean, this is something I can talk to you later. So I think that's really important. But instead of just calling them with a complaint, sometimes you got to call them to praise them. But then you also got to call them up with some just really good questions. And not necessarily browbeat them down when they say no, but come at it with a different approach.
Right. And so,
I was going to say, I love that approach that you mentioned. You know, we ask them, okay, so how do we get to that solution? You know, what can I do for you, or who do I need to go get involved in this to find that solution for all of us?
Well, and how do we get that? How do we get people to understand the process? You know, what education can we give people to let them understand, you know, the constraints that those biologists are no different than our hatchery managers. You know, everybody has a boss. You know, it's not just they get to do whatever they want because that's what they want to do. You know, how do we get the people to understand the process of it all? You know, that's, I don't know. I don't, you know, because a lot of it is you have to believe it. And a lot of people don't want to believe the answers that it takes to fix this problem. You know, they want to just be stuck in that tunnel vision of it's this way. And, you know, you can kill wild steelhead down here. You know, so everybody's like, you want more fish in the river? Quit killing wild steelhead. I personally agree with that, but the data shows that it can sustain it. you know, and that argument has just driven such a wedge between sportsmen, guides, and the biologists that, you know, it's just, I don't know where we come on the same, you know, where we all sit at the table and come up with a solution on the matter.
Right. Yeah, that's a difficult one because, you know, you got people who definitely, you know, like to harvest fish, and for people that have been doing it for a long time. I mean, when we went to the no more harvesting of wild fish on the peninsula, you know, you saw a lot of the old timers just quit. They stopped fishing. You know, that broke my heart. Broke my heart watching those old timers who love to go down there that really had a great wealth of knowledge.
Right.
And they love to do that, right? I'm more of a person that's about, instead of making rules, I'm more about education, right? Educate people, right? Do the best job you can educate. If you don't want, you know, instead of making the rule where Fish and Wildlife says you can keep the wild fish, but a lot of people don't want to, then just educate those people. I started releasing wild steelhead long before we had a rule that says we couldn't, because I educated my clients. I feel my job as a guide to not only provide my clients with an adventure and a fishing trip, but to also educate them on not only the fishery, but the biology and the aspects of the fishing. And when I started explaining it to people, I had more and more people like, oh, you know what? We don't need to kill that. We're good. Just let it go. You know what I mean? Right. And they started enjoying the adventure more than they did the killing. And I think if more and more people were to educate their folks on that, the better, right?
100%. The
better I'll be in terms of that.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the guys, you know, a lot of them, they do a great job in education. But, you know, one of the guys I was talking to the other day, you know, that guy bought that seat and he was adamant. He was killing a fish. That was all there was to it. You have those guys, you know, my fishery up on the lake, you know, after I explained to them how old that fish is and the life cycle that it goes to, you know, it's, if I harvest that fish out of the resource, it's going to take 30 years for a fish to replace that one that you just killed, you know? And so, and then they're like, oh yeah, I had no idea, you know, that these fish are this old, and everybody's, you know, is right on board. You know, I get very little pushback with the no harvest of lake trout up there. Other than your common fake profile, you know, just want to say something to get a reaction out of you on your business page, you know, I just delete it. You know, it is what it is.
Yep.
Not to say that it doesn't fire me up, but I don't, you know, it's, hey, you're entitled to your opinion. Doesn't mean I need to look at it. Right. You know, so
yep.
Definitely education is the key.
So hatcheries are pretty much only one part of the equation for us on our getting our fisheries back to a positive note. So like, what else is there? You know, what's the Washington's Guide Association working towards?
So, I mean, obviously we want better fisheries for our guides. We want better fisheries for our anglers. We want better fisheries for everybody. Right. And so, you know, we're working to try to accomplish that. It's a large task, right? I mean, it's not going to happen tomorrow.
Right.
And it takes a long time to get involved in all that stuff. And so everything's a process. And that process takes a long time, and it's about relationships and so forth, right? So, you know, long-term, Washington State Guide Association is working hard. We were the ones that developed the guide advisory program for the Department of Fish and Wildlife. We got that implemented. We've worked on that. We've gained some great relationships with some senators, legislators, those kind of things. We're working on trying to get some regional directors. So Washington State's a big state, right? So kind of getting a regional director in every location, right? So each corner of the state, probably five locations. They have a regional director for each location. And then hopefully down the road, they have their own meetings in that region that myself and a couple of guide, or, you know, a couple of the executive boards would probably sit in on those meetings, probably not to partake in them, but just to listen, to them and listen to their voice and listen to what they need so that we can go fight their fight for them. Right. And that's really, I mean, that, and then just gaining membership, gaining sponsorship. And then the long-term is, like I said, is just a battle with it, battle in the process of how do we sustain our fisheries? How do we get fisheries that everybody can have? How do we get fisheries that would be long enough and productive enough, you know, for us to have that? I mean, if you go back, you know, years and years and years ago, I mean, you could fish the Puget Sound 365 days a year.
Right.
For salmon.
Right.
And now you're down to, you know, a month here and 4 weeks there, and 2 weeks over here. And I mean, and then it's closed, right? So, you know, you have all that. And you used to have winter steelhead streams that were wild, you had wild producing winter steelhead streams that everybody fished until the end of April. Right. And now we're closing three quarters of those. And I mean, we're just, things are slipping away. And I feel like we can get some stuff back. It's just going to take a process and a road to do that. And it's a long road, and it's a lot of steps. It's not just one step. It's a lot of steps. Right. And a lot of that stuff, some of it's money. Some of it's going to be habitat restoration, helping with habitat restoration projects. The key to a lot of that is going to be legislation, legislators, senators, having those people on your side and on your, with them, right? They're the ones that are going to be pushing the money. They're the ones going to be pushing the ideas through the department and helping generate those things. But there's also the relationships you have within your department, right? Relationships with department people, people that know, you know, I have four or five people that if I call, I'm going to get a call back, and I'm going to get a call back in an hour or two. Right. And I'm going to get the answers that I need or want. They may not be answers that I like.
Right. Right.
But I'm going to get the answers that I need or want. Right. And then if I don't like the answer, that's when we go back to, like I said before, rephrasing the question, rephrasing something else to look at it in a different way. But if you don't have the answer, you know, you can't work on a solution. Right. So creating those relationships with your fish and wildlife people are ultimately super important, along with your legislators and your senators. And then you got to have people within the industry yourself. I mean, you know, it's great that I've met you guys. You know, I know all the guys from Addicted. I know Dwayne from Fish Hunt Northwest. I know, you know, Rob Ensley and those guys from up north. And, you know, there's just a lot of those places. The guys from Fish Hunt North, or the magazine, Fish Northwest magazine, you know, radio guy, I can't remember his name now, and Yakima. I mean, creating those relationships and having conversations like this that just keep spreading farther and farther and farther, right, are how we will eventually get there. It's a process. And long term, you know, Washington State Guide Association would love to start, get enough membership, get enough sponsorship to where we could start the process of maybe either hiring somebody full-time that just does nothing but work on fishing related issues, and or hiring a full-time lobbyist that we can use in Olympia when we are having, when we do have ideas or where we need help in the legislative process, is having a lobbyist to do that.
Does the CCA do any of that? Do you know? Do they hire lobbyists?
They do. They do. However, I think, and don't quote me on this, I'm not positive, I believe their lobbyist has stepped down from there. Part of the problem with lobbyists is they're expensive. And the guy that was helping them out helped him out a lot, but that was just a portion of what he did. And his comments were basically was that, you know, I'm spending more time fighting fishing related issues now instead of my other stuff, and I get paid a fraction of the money for the fishing related stuff.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean? So it's not just not worth it anymore for me to help fight this stuff when I make more money doing this and I'm taking too much time away from that. So but we're in the conversations with some folks and trying to figure out, you know, what can we do for a lobbyist and how we can work that out. And I mean, we've got a lot of irons in the fire. They just take time to flesh them all out to develop something.
Just curious, do you know that dollar amount that it takes to basically hire a lobbyist? If we could have kept this guy on full time.
So recently I've heard at least $5,000 a month.
Okay.
At least $5,000 a month. And I know that I don't know it. I know that CCA was not paying him that much.
Gotcha. Because I mean, that's not.
That'd be the bare minimum. It would be $5,000 a month.
That doesn't seem like, even that doesn't seem like much for somebody to be fighting the fight full time.
No, it's not at all. It's really not when you think of the grand scheme of things, right? But I think that would kind of allude us to the idea that, I mean, you and I look at it that way. I look at the hundreds of thousands of fishermen that fish.
Yeah, exactly.
$5,000 is a penny in the bucket.
Yeah. Right.
If you could get the hundreds of thousands of fishermen that fish to actually put a little bit of money forward to do that.
Right.
You know what I mean? But it goes back to what Todd was saying before, and that's the division thing, right? So You have all these mega organizations. You got CCA, you got the Washington State Guide Association, you got Puget Sound Anglers, you got Northwest Steelheaders, you know, have these different organizations that are open. NSIA is another one, you know. You got these different organizations, and I guarantee you, if you asked every person in the room about each one of those organizations, the first thing they would say is one bad thing about each one of them.
No, I completely agree.
They really would.
Yep.
And I would say, all right, now tell me two good things about each one of them.
Right.
Why are we focusing on the bad?
100%.
Let's focus on the good, right?
Because for sure.
The reality of it is, I'm a CCA member. Do I agree with everything CCA does?
No.
I'm a Puget Sound Anglers member. Do I agree with every single thing they do? No.
Right.
So each group is going to do something that you're probably not going to be 100% on board on.
For sure.
I can tell you a lot of good things they all do. They all advocate every day for the benefit of us to go
well,
fishing. And they all fight for us. And if we could actually get those groups to sit at a table together.
$5,000 a month is all of a sudden isn't a lot of money. It's not even like, I mean, if they would all just pitch in, you know, a little bit, you can reach that sum really fast, you know, to where they're lobbying for, you know, the common goal of what we all believe. You know, like you said, there's parts of everything that nobody, there's parts of guiding in a day that I don't like.
Yep.
You know, doesn't mean I don't like guiding.
Right. There's just walls that have been built up.
Oh, you know, for sure.
Between organizations, there's walls been built up between, you know, sport anglers and organizations and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I don't know how many people, you know, CCA was going to be the ticket that was going to fix everything, you know, and CCA has done a lot of really good stuff.
You know,
but CCA is also not a little ticket item. They're a big ticket item, meaning they don't fight small fight. They're fighting big fight, right?
Right.
And so when you fight a big fight, takes a long time to win with a whole lot of little tiny battles in between, right?
Right.
And so, you know, the Washington State Guide Association, we have a list of big fights. Then we have a huge list of little fights, right?
Right.
And we take on all the little ones. Our main goal is the big ones, but we're definitely going to fight the little ones more productively, knowing we have a chance that we're going to win some battles and we're going to win some things. And all those little things are making changes, right? And that helps in the long haul. And those little things that you do are the ones that are securing those relationships,
right,
with the department people, with your legislators, with those folks. I mean, I don't, that addicted show that we were just talking about, that was last week that I was on.
Right.
We had a senator that actually watched that, called the Olympic or the Washington State Guides Association and said, as a senator, how do I become an angler member?
That's awesome. Those guys do a great job. You know, the, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, I fish with those guys and, you know, we've built our relationship. I think a lot of it is I founded a nonprofit down here in Southern Oregon. And I was really quick to learn one of the problems is everybody wants to, everybody has this unrealistic idea of we're fighting for the same money, the same donations. And what I, you know, I mean, one of the things I've said the most is, you know, individually, we're really hard to hear. Collectively, we're really hard to ignore. We're not fighting over the same money. We all have our own different ideas of where our passion is, you know, and who we donate to. And we got to get, you know, we got to get rid of this division. I mean, that's literally of, there's a place for CC, I mean, they're fighting fights that we, you know, as a smaller group, we can't fight, but we need them fighting those big fights because they can do that. It's the, you know, getting back to the paid person. Absolutely. We have to get people to understand, you know, I mean, you touched the base on it with the addicted show a little bit on people are unrealistic on how much money the opposition spends and where they spend it. They're paying people a lot more than $5,000 a month to take this away from all of us. And it's not even, they're not even feeling the hurt because of the money backing them.
No, they have major organizations, like major, huge, multi-million dollar organizations pumping money into their organizations and paying individuals to fight every day for those stuff, right? That's what those people do.
And people don't understand the power of their dollar. I literally just talked to a guy today that bought some, I'll say it, Sims gear. And if you look at what they support, they literally support direct against what we stand for. And his response was, yeah, so it's good gear, so I bought it. Yeah. I mean, literally those are the exact words that he told.
Yeah.
And I was like, how much sense does that make? You know, there's certain parts of what you just spent that's going right towards you being out of a job.
Yep.
Yeah, but it's only one pair, so what am I going to do? You know, people have that. It astounded me. I was like, you got to be kidding me.
People don't understand that they vote with their money. You know, anytime you spend a dollar anywhere, you're voting for that company's beliefs. It doesn't matter if you actually believe it or not, but you are saying that you support that.
It's a lot like the business card. It's if I hand out your business card, that is a reflection of me.
For sure.
So it seems like, you know, we're talking about hiring people. So the fish here in the Northwest, you know, they are the bloodline of our economy. So if we were to invest in this, you know, it doesn't matter if you were like a realtor or a doctor or run any kind of business. If you wanted your business to do better, it seems like you should be investing in the fisheries here in the Northwest because, you know, there's more money coming in. So your business is going to be doing better. Why aren't people realizing that, I guess, is my question.
I think it goes back to the idea that when you go into a store and you want to buy that nice new fancy reel of yours, you put the money on the counter, they hand you the reel, and you go out and you get to go fishing with it, right? A lot of the folks that put their money in an organization and they give you your money. We're in this society now, like with Amazon, where you can buy something and it's at your doorstep the next day. Right.
Right. Right.
And everybody wants a quick fix. They, here's my money. Okay. Now what'd you do with it? And how come it's not better? And how come I'm not fishing tomorrow and it's closed still. Right. They want something quicker. And unfortunately, it's just not how it works. We'll never be able to do that. It's just not.
Right.
And people need to understand it's a process. You know what I mean? So what's CCA been in Oregon and Washington? 15 years?
Somewhere right around there.
Yeah, somewhere like 15 years. And a regular membership is $25, I think, for a regular person, something like that. Like a guide membership is 125 or 150 or something like that. You know what I mean? So, you know, as a guide, you know, you give them what, $1,800, $1,500 over 15 years?
Right.
I know guys that like go and buy new rods and reels every year for that.
Right.
So go ahead and use those rods for 2 years because they still catch fish, and go ahead and put some money towards something that is actually going to allow you to fish the next year with those rods.
Right.
Right. And so I think a lot of that is, that's my big thing on it. A lot of it is just that is just, they just want instantaneous success. And the other thing is this, like, it seems to be not as big of a deal anymore. People want to, like, they say they want to be involved, but involvement takes some time, right? You want to be involved in your child's life, then you got to invest some time. You got to invest some money. You got to invest some money into your marriage. If you want to have your boat run on a regular basis all the time, you got to invest a little bit of maintenance, right? The way I look at fishing organizations, it's maintenance for fishing opportunities in the future, right? Put a little money in it, right? Guarantee you, most of us just don't go to dinner once this week.
Right? That's all it takes.
Don't go to dinner. It's expensive. You know, take that money and put it towards an organization. Do that four times a year. You've joined the majority of the organizations. Oh, and by the way, when they send out an email with their meeting minutes and what they were talking about, read them. Actually read them.
Right.
So that you know what they were talking about. I don't know how many people have asked me, like, well, God, I'm a member and I don't ever hear anything. Well, did you get the meeting minutes? Well, yeah. Did you read it? Well, no. Then how are you going to know what's going on? Like, I can't call every single person and tell you what my meeting minutes were and what conversations we're hawking. And, oh, by the way, on the bottom of those meeting minutes, we also sent you a call to action deal that said, here's a letter. All you got to do is sign it and click send to this senator.
And most people don't do that.
And you didn't do it because you didn't read the meeting minutes.
Right.
Right? Right? So that's like part of the problem, right? Like it's frustrating because it's frustrating at times because so many people, I have responded on social media sites. I swear I've responded 5,000 times to people on issues and deleted them before I sent them because I wanted to say stuff and I'm like, well, that's unprofessional. That's not right way to talk. So I'm not going to send it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right. Cause I was doing it out of frustration and not out of professionalism. Right. And so, but it gets really tiring I'll just take the coastal steelhead issue for example. There's been a pile of guides pissed off, upset, sent photos. They put photos on their Facebook pages. Oh, how cool would it? I mean, I didn't get to fish Marsh Madness this year. And look at these wild fish that I normally would have caught. And they're all boo-hooing and they're complaining. And they're, oh, how glorious this would have been. And, oh, the joys of used to fish April steelhead we don't have anymore. And all that kind of stuff. And I want to respond is like, oh, that's nice. So which meeting have you been on? Like, which one have you attended? Like, do you really care that much or you just want everybody to care that you're whining about not being able to fish? Because that's what you're doing, right?
Yeah.
It's like, put your foot forward and actually do something. And I said it on Addicted and I'll say it on here. There's two ways of joining and being involved. One is doing something like what you guys are doing, right? But the reality of it is, you know, as I do, if there's 75 people watching this podcast, there can't be 75 Steves and Thiel and Todds on this Zoom screen having this conversation, right? And there's just two of you that can have this conversation, okay? And it's just like, there doesn't need to be 75 people calling a local biologist when Todd can call the local biologist and accomplish everything he needs to accomplish, right? So you're going to have worker bees, you're going to have the people behind it and the workers, and then you're going to have the people behind it who are the supporters, right?
Yep.
And so if you want to be Steve or Todd or Bob or Marlon or Cameron or Dwayne or anybody else that's an advocate for the fishery, you want to be one of those people, please join, help us. We'll walk right alongside you and we'll fight the fight side by side, arm in arm. But I also understand that you can't do that. Not everybody's going to be able to do that. Not everybody has the will to do it. I know some people that are really good guys who are very passionate that probably should never talk to any politician or any wild biologist ever.
I would agree with that.
Right? Just because I would agree you're going to say more to screw it up than you are going to say good. Right. Not that you're a bad person. You just don't. You just can't speak without your passion overrunning you.
Right.
And so those people need to be supporters. And there's so many other people that need to be supporters, right? Know that there's somebody in your corner fighting, but the way they fight is through your support.
Yeah.
And so if you're not going to be the guy to get on every one of those meetings, if you're not going to be the guy to sit in front of this computer day after day after day, evening after evening after evening, having these kind of conversations, then be the supporter. Right. And the support comes through your donation and your involvement in that donation. That involvement is reading the emails that are sent to you, responding to them when they ask you to respond, right?
Right.
And fight that. I'm sorry. You have an issue that comes up. Just an issue, any issue. And, you know, and I talk to Fish and Wildlife all the time, right? I work with them closely. And a big issue came up. And I'll say, well, how many comments did you get on the issue? Oh, we got 162. I'm like, 162 comments on this serious of an issue. There should be no less than 10 or 15,000
right.
comments.
Right.
On a big issue, right? That should be the bare minimum, right? The bare minimum should be that, because the reality is that not only should everybody that's watching this respond to a comment, respond, not everybody's watching Addicted, Dwayne, everybody else. Todd's a full-time guide. Every one of his clients should know about it. Every one of my clients should know about it. Every one of every other guides around clients should know about it. And if they all responded, miraculous things would start to happen.
Right.
But the miraculous things aren't happening because people are not responding. Our Coastal Steelhead ad hoc group right now, it's a 2-hour meeting in the afternoons. We're on the cusp of losing wild steelheading on the peninsula, that kind of stuff.
Right.
There's 12 advisory members on the council, on the board, that are talking. We've had like 30 or 40 people on the other side of the Zoom call listening into the meeting, where they at the end can either make a public comment or they can go online and make comments.
Yeah, I think people are, I mean, you know, like we talked right before we got on, you know, I was one of those guys. You know, I did the bare minimum to make me feel good about me giving back without really giving back. And it wasn't until, you know, we looked in the mirror and was honest with ourselves of, all right, the facade is over. You know, what got my attention was the shutting fishing down, you know, no fishing out of a floating device. And then it seemed like it was next day, it was, you know what, no fishing. it, you know, for us down here, it just happened really, really fast. You know, I'm sure it was a lot, you know, a little bit slower for you guys, but it woke me up and how important right now is we have to be proactive instead of react. You guys are fighting the reactive fight right now.
Yep.
We are still fortunate enough to be able to fight the proactive fight. And that literally is what gave me the boost to do what you said, get off of my ass and start being involved, you know, really being involved. And this is, you know, this is my personal starting point of what was this endeavor that we're getting ready to, that we're embarking on right now. And hopefully other people get rid, you know, it is what it is. You know, I mean, it's, hey, I can't change anything I did last year, but moving forward this year, I can make a huge impact. And hopefully we get the community around us to support, you know, we got to stop this from happening to us because it's coming. Whether we want to admit it or not, put our heads in the sand, it's coming for us as well.
Oh, yeah. No, I agree with you. I agree with you, and I commend you guys for being proactive in it because I think it's super important. You get a foot in the door beforehand, and you start working in the right steps going forward now, that's going to be a lot different game down the road. I think you're on the right track, and I commend you guys for doing that. It's good.
So one question I have for you, Bob, you mentioned that all the organizations are pretty separate. You know, they all kind of hate each other secretly. How do we bring everybody together, you know, start building that cohesive group instead of everybody trying to fight their own fight?
I wouldn't say they all hate each other. They just all have different agendas and so forth. I would say that there's a couple of organizations that probably have a little bit more dislike for each other than other ones. I think you raise a good question. I think it's a great question, right? And I guess that the question then would be, to do it's easy,
right?
To do it's easy. That's the easy part. The doing it part is easy. You pick up the phone call and you just call the heads of each of those organizations and say, hey, let's have a Zoom meeting and let's have a conversation. And just bring exactly what we just got done talking about. Like there's division between us, not between us, just division amongst groups.
Right.
That if we were all to join together in something, things, then how much more powerful would we all be fighting those seams, and what can we work together to fight, right? And I don't think myself knowing the majority of the leadership of those groups, the majority of them would be, yeah, you're right. And how do we start that process, right? You know, the thing is that probably that's the conversation needs to take place versus picking an item. Right.
So, well, I think,
you know, picking an item sometimes is the hardest thing. You know, there's a bunch of people right now that want like Snake River dams removed. Right. And so whether or not you want Snake River dams removed or not. Right.
Right.
Oh, you're not with us. Oh, you're against us. No, I didn't say I was against you. That's just not one of the battles that my organization wants to take on. Right. My organization wants to fight some of this other stuff. I'm not saying I'm against you at all.
Right.
It's just something that it doesn't fit within the parameters of our organization. And when we talk to my board of directors, we would rather spend our time and our energy on these things over here. Doesn't mean that we don't support you.
Well, because everything has value. And, you know, we just need... I think, you know, when I hear the word lobby, I guess, you know, that's kind of where my mind went was, you know, paying somebody to lobby amongst our groups. You know, we need lobbyists, you know, above that, but we need to start with a paid lobbyist to get that get that communication within all these groups, you know, us and everybody else, to start that ball and then move up to the next, you know, to the next lobbyist. You know, that's kind of where my mind went of, we got to get one or two people to get these groups together, and it takes money. You know, if you're not guiding, you're not feeding your family. If I'm not fishing, I'm not feeding my family. And so, you know, that's where it's got to start. Cause once you can make that happen, I really, like you're saying, I think sky's the limit. You can get so much more done.
So there, right now there's not, I assume from our conversation, there's not one person that, like, the CCA, all your organizations, the ones in Oregon, that they could all go to say, hey, this is what's going on, these are the issues, and that one person is fighting that political battle, those political battles for us. You know, because, I mean, that seems like what we need is all these organizations report to one person, give them the information, and then that person or team of people then goes and fights those fights for us.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately that would be the awesome deal to have that, right? However, I think you're going to find that pretty difficult to have, you know, like one guy that's going to fight all the fights for all the groups.
I guess it wouldn't necessarily be fighting all the fights, but it would be having that knowledge and what the issues are. You know, CCA is fighting the political battles. You've got the hatchery groups. You've got everybody that has their issues, but they can go to that specific person and tell them, give them the data of what's going on. And then they have that data to be able to, you know, when they go do these political fights, they have that data to convey to our senators or whoever they need to convey it to. Do we have something like, Department of Fish and Wildlife does?
Nah, not necessarily, because they're not necessarily fighting the fight for you all the time, right?
Yeah.
So I envision, you guys have got me buggered up now. You got my brain going a million miles an hour.
Good luck sleeping.
And I think kind of like almost throwing down a challenge. It would almost be better if you had like an industry, almost like an industry meeting.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Either quarterly or something along that lines, where you contacted, where you had the guide associations, you had various groups come together, you had CCA, Puget Sound Anglers, NSIA, you know, Northwest Steelheaders, you guys, Addicted, Dwayne,
all of them,
all those guys, and you pulled together some kind of industry meeting. And you say, I would like to form an industry meeting and actually try to put together a you know, quarterly industry wide meeting kind of thing. And try to basically start out with just basically the conversation we're having, introduce everybody, right, and just say, hey, look, we all understand everybody's doing something different. Everybody's got to fight. You know, Puget Sound Anglers are Puget Sound Anglers.
Right.
They basically fight for the Puget Sound and all the tributaries of the Puget Sound, right? So the Olympic Peninsula Guide Association probably doesn't care what they're doing in the Puget Sound because they're over there on the coast. And just like they probably don't care what's going on the coast. Mm-hmm. They care. They just don't care enough to, like, be overly involved in it. Just like they don't be overly involved in Puget Sound, right? And they don't overly care what's going on the Columbia River, you know? But they need to understand, as brothers and sisters in arms, we got to care about each other.
Right.
And we got to care about the whole process for everybody. Right. You guys are like your conversation. You said it earlier, it's coming downhill your way.
Yeah.
Right. It's going to come that way. Right. Yep. And the impacts that are happening on the coast right now, or Puget Sound, so forth, you know, all those impacts are headed another direction. Exactly. People love to fish and hunt. They're going to go fishing and hunting. as opposed to going every morning or going after work one night where they can just go to their local river. They just start planning vacations. They start planning times, right? You know, if the coast continues to be close, I'm going to be calling Todd going, hey, Todd, what's going on? I'm going to be in your backyard. See you next week. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. No, that's exactly what's going
to
happen.
And I won't be that guy, by the way, Todd. But there will be guys that will be, right?
There are, yes.
They will move around. They are going to move. And then the thing with moving is those problems now just move with you.
Right.
You exasperated what was going on. Now you just exasperated in another location, right? Yep. Because the pressure just moved there, and now the conservation pressure will move with you. And it just keeps moving around, right?
The
industry needs to understand that that's what's happening. That's what's going to happen.
Right.
And the only way we get out of this is when we all band together and start keeping a common term. But I would also voice my opinion in saying that there are some things in that I would, I mean, if I were the person that was to talk about those issues, I would say right off the bat, okay, Columbia River gill nets, off topic, not happening. Snake River dams, off topic, not happening. Right?
Right.
Like, those are two huge issues. Okay? Maybe right now maybe down the road we talk about that. Right now, we're not talking about those two issues.
Right.
Name all the other issues we can talk about, right? Because those two right now are just nothing but they're dead stop.
They're time wasters.
They're done.
They're right? Time wasters.
You're just going to argue. People are going to get upset. They're just not going to want to talk about it because that's what they're focusing on. And so I think we'd have to have that conversation. So it's an interesting, I need to talk this over with Doug and see what maybe we can do to.
Well, and kind of
something, you know, like that.
How we come up with these, you know, with having this conversation was, you know, with your addicted, when you were talking with the boys over there, you know, I think I remember you saying that's how we're getting beat is, you know, is that separation between all the groups. And we got one big group fighting us, you know, they have their agenda and we are all in their sights. And if we don't pull together and fight like they're fighting us, we are setting ourselves up for failure. I don't care how much passion, love, and respect you have for our industry. It's not enough because we have to fight at the same, we have to fight in the same ring as they're fighting it. Right. You know, that literally is where we're losing. We have to fix this, you know, that's, and so, you know, I mean, yeah, it's, we'll get the, it is a challenge. Bob, I want you to take it directly as a challenge of we're going to need you to get all these organizations together.
Perfect. Thanks, Bob.
Now we just got to talk, how much money do you need? But, you know, I mean, that is something, you know, when we get off here, that is something I know we would like to talk to you about of, you know, behind the scenes of what it's going to take, you know, so we can absorb that into kind of our direction. Because that is truly, you know, we both feel very passionate about how this has got to be navigated.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's a big deal. And that's what we're trying to do with the Washington State Guide Association is kind of directing that and trying to get to that to the point. I mean, you asked the question earlier, how the heck do you do all these meetings? And Doug is the same way. You know, Doug and I have both vowed, people have said, oh, you're not involved in the North of Falcon process. Well, we are this year because we've been to every single meeting, either him or I or both of us. You know what I mean? And I'm going to listen to places about river systems and stuff that I don't fish at all. But I'm going there because I want to know what those people are fighting. I want to know what those people are dealing with. So that I have an innate knowledge of it, right? So when somebody calls and asks me, well, what about this? Or what about this? Like, no, this is what they're dealing with. And this is my opinion on it.
Right.
And I've called some of the people that are in that area to ask them about what they're dealing with. and how they're dealing with it, and what kind of help do they need? You know what I mean? And,
yeah.
You know, and most of them need a voice, and that's what, as the Washington State Guide Association, we're trying to be a voice, right? We're trying to gain those relationships, gain those relationships with legislators, senators, representatives, gain those voices within the department, gain those voices with people outside of the department, and in other organizations, you know. Doug has other organizations that he's talks to on a regular basis. He knows a couple guys from the Puget, he knows Ron Garner from the Washington or Puget Sound Anglers group really well. And so he talks with him. In fact, I think they got him scheduled to join our next Washington State Guide Association meeting, you know, and converse with us. And so that would be a great starting point to have a conversation with him. You know, I need to talk with like Nello Pasinich with CCA, you know, Liz Hamilton with NSIA. I think Brian McLaughlin is with Northwest Steelheaders. You know, there's just a bunch of people that we can contact to start these conversations.
Right.
And so forth. That's kind of how the Coastal Steelhead one got. I mean, as I saw a problem with this no fishing from a floating device thing, and that was just going to continue. And so I put together what I called a steelhead work group, and I got like four different organizations together from Washington and Oregon. And I had two senators involved in the organization, and there was nine of us. And there was a couple of silent people that were pretty powerful and knowledgeable that were in there also. But we started working together to come up with, you know, how we're going to fight this. And we fought it right through legislation, and we fought it through a budget proviso. And we got a budget proviso passed for $300,000 through the legislation. And that was myself and Doug that did that. And we got that involved, and we ended up getting this Coastal Steelhead Advisory Group because of that budget proviso. Of course, we've created quite the hornet's nest with it.
Right.
But the reality of it is you can't knock the hornet's nest down until you get involved at the hornet's nest. So, you know what I mean? So yeah. you got to have to work with them. And so we're hopefully going to work with a plan on that and try to get some form of management for our coastal steelhead headed in the right direction to allow us to have fishing and normal fishing, you know, for future years.
These loss of opportunities that you guys are having up there in Washington, like how do they come about? Because I know, yes, the runs are declining, but even if you left it open for catch and release fishing, that's still going to drive a lot of money into those local economies, you know? So how does the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife justify closing off these opportunities for people when they're basically shutting off the money valve to those same communities?
Long story short, I mean, we could spend another 2 hours talking about this, but
right.
The long story short is this, is that, and I tell people, and they're frustrated with it, but here's the reality of the answer, is we can't defend our fishery. When I say we can't defend our fishery, yeah, I know it's a catch and release fishery. There's a mortality that's established with catch and release, right? And so in the state of Washington, we use 10%, right? And so we base our runs in Washington off of a forecasted run, and we forecast the run. Here's your fishing opportunity. Of course, we have co-managers in our state tribes, right? And so they get 50% of that harvestable opportunity, and the sportsmen get the other 50% of their harvestable opportunity. The tribe can account for every single fish they catch in their net. They take it to a fish processor. Every one of them is counted, right? On a sport fishery side, we can't defend it because we have no way of counting what we're catching or knowing that, right? So we don't have enough creel checkers or fish monitoring in place to have all the fishermen come in. Well, how many did you catch today, right? So these conservation groups have convinced Fish and Wildlife that our catch and release fishery is possibly catching every single steelhead in the system one time or one and a half times.
But right? I mean, my understanding,
I find that absolutely retarded. And not, it's not even remotely close.
Well, I mean, I've talked with like Scott Ammerman. The studies say it's like 7 to 12% of a run that sports fishermen catch. So, I mean, if you're only hitting that percent of a run, and then on top of that, your mortality rate is 10%, which the latest studies I've seen actually put it closer to like 3% on steelhead. You know, right. So that 3 to 10%, and you're only catching about 10% of the run to begin with. So I mean, if you have 10,000 fish coming back, that mortality rate, you're only killing, what, 100 fish, if that? You know, so I don't understand where that justification can come from, where they say, hey, you caught every single fish in that river, and 10% of them died. Well, that's obviously a lie. You know, so how can we justify that?
So I would start with, this is a data fight, right?
Yeah. Yep.
This is a scientific data fight. So if Scott has data that says that the anglers only catch whatever you said, 7 to 10% or 7 to 12% or something of a run size, right? If he had data to support that, then I would like to see that data, right? I would, and I'll call Scott. If Scott has that data, I'll call him.
I don't know. Right. Yeah, I don't know if that's a scientific study or if that's just what he's seen.
But it's worth a phone call to Scott to ask. And I met with Scott here a couple of weeks ago at the Solette's rendezvous thing they had down there. I went down and helped them with their broodstock program. And I did that. So Scott said, call him. So I will. If that's the case, if we have data to support that, then that's data that we need to bring to Fish and Wildlife and show them that, right? Right now, we don't have that data. And so their data is showing that, based on their escapement numbers, based on the number of fish that they've looked at in not only creel counts, but in punch card records from years past, that we could be catching those numbers of fish. Everybody agrees with you that like it's not possible. There's no way, right?
No. You get a high water
event. And the 10% is, let's say our escapement, let's say the 50% that we could handle was 1,200 fish. At 10%, we'd have to catch 12,000 to reach our 50% of our allowable harvest, right?
Right.
They know that conservatively, 10% is a conservative number, right? The Idaho study showed 3.75%, I think, as the Idaho study showed. Washington's doing their own hook and release mortality study right now. Preliminary numbers are coming out at that 3% area, gotcha. Right? So, I mean, those are two good things. And if we have that data, then we can go to the department and say, okay, now we have two different data sources saying that we only catch 3% or our mortality is only 3%. So we need to lower our mortality in our forecasting now to 3%. And if you, we'll give you a percent or two, and let's go to 5, right? Just for conservative measure, right? So that's going to change then how we would look at a fishery for sure, right? But the bigger issue is that we can't support our fishery without a lack of data, right? So they have no clue how many fish we're catching.
Right.
If we are catching huge amounts of fish, and we pretend to are reaching our harvestable number, right? So the answer is, for your answer is remember what I said before is you don't like the answer, ask it differently, right?
Yeah.
Well, for me, the answer now is not whether or not your data is correct, but how do I help you attain the data that you need to support what you're asking or saying. How do I help you do that?
Right?
Do you need money? I'll help you go to the legislature to get more money for monitoring.
Well,
how else do we do it, right?
In Oregon, we have the app on our phone now to record our harvest. You just add a button in there that says wild fish released or whatever. And how many did you release today? And then all of a sudden, now you have a data source.
Yes, Washington. Washington is in the process. Okay, they're in the process. They have money appointed to them from the legislature this year to work on electronic punch cards and electronic monitoring. So that is in the cards. We might be a year or two down the road, but it is in the works. All right. So that's a positive thing. That's in the works. So, and there was also a bunch of money appropriated this year to the department for more surveying and monitoring. So there's a likelihood that next year we could have a better, more creel checkers on the river and more monitoring on the river to find out what we're actually catching and so forth. But I will also go back to your original comment on was, what is the issue with the catch and releasing? And I would still argue that same question. Like, we're catching and releasing with single barbless hooks, no bait. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like that, yeah. you can't, the only other way to manage a fishery anymore is just close it. Right.
Yeah.
And hence that's what they just did. Right. So,
but so I mean, if you leave it open,
in there, we have to have the department look at that and go, okay, and recognize that catch and release is like the rawest form of fishing you can get to.
Right. And right? If you leave it open to catch and release fishing, you're still allowing, I mean, it's probably, I don't know what a month of the season is going to cost you, but it's probably, we're talking upwards of billions of dollars in local economic activity from all the fishermen coming in for that.
Yeah.
And that's just for leaving it open for catch and release. You know, that doesn't include extra people that would come if they could actually harvest it.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No. It smashed. It smashed Forks.
I bet.
Bad.
Yeah, I bet.
You know, it smashed Forks bad. We lost April last year. You know, they closed April. They left it open through March last year, but closed April. And we always had April too. And so now we don't get April anymore. And then this year they closed March and April. And so, yes, I mean, they're feeling the full effects of these closures. And that is something that we're talking about within the Coastal Steelhead Ad Hoc group, is the social economics of closures and these management decisions. So it will be a subject of conversation. We haven't had that conversation yet, but it will be a subject of conversation.
Yeah, because I mean, if you're the governor running the state, you know, that's your business. So if somebody made this decision that just cost my cities millions of dollars, I mean, if I was running that business, you'd be fired. You know, it's pretty plain and simple. So it just baffles me that we allow these agencies just to completely shut things down on a whim. And that's costing us millions of dollars.
Oh yeah. No, I hear you. For sure.
Todd, do you have anything else for Bob this evening?
No, that pretty much sums it up for me. And just so much information that I'm really seeking right now that, you know, it's the, I can't get enough of it. I think there's like Bob said, you know, we have to, this is how you start the conversation, is by doing this. You know, like you said, that's the, everybody that, you know, wants to drag you down. They're just afraid to start something, you know, because they don't want to look inadequate, you know, or whatever. And I literally, I'm past the point of, it's not about me. It's about the future, you know? And if I have to look inadequate to ask questions that I just don't understand, then so be it. You're not going to please everybody all the time. But hopefully that it gives people the incentive to say, hey, I don't have to know everything. It's okay that I reach out and listen to this stuff and educate myself in what I think needs to happen. I don't know if it's right. I don't know if it's wrong. All I know is if we have a conversation to, you know, hopefully Bob took some things away from us tonight to, you know, maybe, okay, maybe it looks a little bit different than what I thought, you know, because we all get a little bit of tunnel vision. I don't care who you are. But it just broadens that vision back out to the possibilities of what can be done. So thank you, Bob. I really enjoyed tonight. Thank you very much.
Good. Yeah, it's my pleasure, guys. And I hope hope this is just beginning of a partnership and a relationship, and I hope that we'll be working together for years to come, and we'll help support each other in yes. fisheries across the Pacific Northwest. And it takes all a bunch of us to do this and get a fire in our bellies to actually instrument change. And I know we can do it. It's going to be a process and it's going to take time, but I'm confident we can do it. And
well
we just got to keep charging forward.
And I really want people to understand that, you know, because they're going to say, well, it's on the peninsula of Washington. How does that affect me in Southern Oregon? And I hope they understand it directly affects us without us supporting you and what's going on up there right now. Because when that fight gets down here, we will already have the data we need to fight that fight down here. You know, I mean, it's not in our backyard by any means, but it is critical that we get behind you and you guys up there to combat this right now. I mean, it is that important.
Yeah. The people that are beating us are using people from all over the United States.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. We're not talking about just little state to little state. They're using the whole United States, right? They have every one of their members are sending in emails, sending in comments from all over the world. Some of them have never even fished there. And they're still sending in comments based on what those people are telling them to say.
Right.
Right. That's what's going on, right? They're doing that. The difference is, I don't want to be the bad guy, but at the same time, sometimes you got to be the bad guy. Yeah. And that is their difference is, when they ask their folks and their fishermen to write an email or send a letter, they do.
Yep.
Right? They do. And that's what we need to do, right? I mean, I swear, if everybody that was on the Columbia River today signed one email and sent it to our governor or sent it to our Fish and Wildlife that said the right thing on it, the governor's office or the Department of Fish and Wildlife's office would be reeling back on their heels and trying to figure out where that punch came from and how hard they just got hit.
Right.
Right. And that's just the people that were on the Columbia River, not every other system in the Pacific Northwest. Right. And there are thousands of anglers everywhere fishing all kinds of other things.
Oh yeah.
And it's just, you know, I know you mentioned lake trout, right?
Yeah.
In Washington, if you go back 20 years ago, nobody cared about a kokanee.
Right.
Nobody cared about a walleye. Right? Why do you think people are fishing walleyes and kokanees now?
Because of the decline of steelhead salmon.
Because their steelhead and salmon fisheries declined enough and they didn't have an open seasons to go.
Exactly.
So all of a sudden, we have now kokanee seminars and kokanee rods and kokanee tackle and walleye seminars and walleye rods. And we have guides booked fully for walleyes and guides booked fully for kokanee.
You know, I did it with lake trout.
Around. So if you're a bass fisherman, be prepared.
Yeah.
Because pretty soon them guys are going to have bass boats and they're going to be guiding bass anglers.
I literally just told the young man we had on last night, if you're starting a guide business, I'm going bass.
Oh,
My market is huge.
Oh.
And nobody's doing it.
No. There's two bass guides in Western Washington that I knew of.
Right.
Two of them. And I went with one of them last year, and it was really fun.
Yeah. And so, I mean, you know.
Yeah, everybody needs to be involved. It doesn't matter how you fish, what you fish, anything. Join an organization. Join all the organizations. Stop buying hamburgers for a week.
Right.
You know what I mean? Don't buy that reel just because you want it. Buy it in a month. But join something. Be involved. And when somebody says, hey, there's a meeting, or hey, send this email, or hey, this is really important, you know, send in something, because I guarantee you have opinion and your opinions are worthwhile. Right. Yeah. Everybody has an opinion. It's worthwhile. And when you comment to Oregon Fish and Wildlife, or if you comment to Washington Fish and Wildlife, please do it very respectfully.
Yes.
Do it very professionally and give them what your heart's telling you. But just give them that part. Don't give them the, you suck, you're horrible. Those comments are basically just round. They just go in the round file. Right. Yeah. And no matter, even though you have really good things to say in the end, the beginning never got you there.
No, I agree. And the delivery is just as important as the message.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Right. So you do that and do those and, you know, and be involved. It doesn't take a lot of time. And 90% of the time when we do a call to action, we've already typed the email.
Right.
All you got to do is put your name in and go send.
Yeah.
Right. And we give you who to send it to. Right. Right. And believe me, like I said, when the Fish and Wildlife Office gets 15,000 emails in a day on one issue, their heads will turn.
Right.
Right. Because I don't know how many times I've been in a meeting and said, this is what they said. Well, we got this many comments and the overwhelming response was this. This is why we're going in this direction. Right. Let that sink in for a second. This is how many emails we got. This is what the overwhelming response was. This is the direction we're going.
Right.
You're basically casting a vote.
You want the direction changed? Then change it. And you have the power to do so by the power of masses. Want to go either harvest a salmon or catch wild steelhead, or you want to fish out of a boat, or you want to do those things. Believe me, we can overpower those decisions. We just have to step up and do it.
Yes.
I like it. So Bob, at the end of every episode, we like to ask our guests for a piece of alpha. So what that is what is the best piece of advice that you could give somebody watching this right now? It could be life advice. It could be fishing advice, but that one piece of advice that you think everybody should know.
It can be about crypto too, Bob.
Oh man, for me, I would have to say, for me personally,
yep,
live your life to the fullest and live it with passion.
I like it.
That's me. I mean, we have a whole nother conversation if you want. Fishing is a part of my life. It's a small part of my life compared to all the rest of my life. And that would be one. Live your life to the fullest and live it with passion.
Yeah, I love it. All right. Well, thank you very much for your time tonight, Bob. We really appreciate it. I think this is a conversation everybody needs to hear. I think it was super helpful and hopefully super informative for all the viewers as well. And everybody watching, thank you for tuning in as well. We appreciate your support. If you'd like more information, Bob, where could somebody find you if they want more information on any, whether Anglers, your guide service?
Yeah, anglersguideservice.com.
All right.
They can also look up Washington State Guides Association.
Perfect. I think we've actually already got links for those down in the description.
If anybody actually wants to call and talk to me, I mean, I have no problem doing that. My phone number is 360-271-7197. I'm open for conversation. If I don't answer, I'll get back to you within a day or so. But if you got questions or comments or something, you have an idea you want to talk out, that's how we grow. And that's how we get better, is by listening to people.
I agree. All right. Well, thank you everybody again for tuning in tonight. Yep. If you would like more information on what Todd and I are doing, it's the northwestfishing.club is our website. Be sure to subscribe to the channel, give this video a like. It all helps with the algorithm and helps spreads the word about this conversation that we just had. We'll be back next week with some more guests. And in the meantime, we have a giveaway going on social media. It's posted to the top of our Facebook and Twitter profiles. It gives you a chance to win a free membership with what we're doing here. And all the links for Bob's guide service and what we're doing are down in the description. So thank you again, and have a good evening, everybody. All right, guys.